So, again, I have some time to get ready with the technicals. And right now, it's time for Toastmaster Tejas Project 10. We know that as a mark of celebration, we must all give a standing ovation once his speech is concluded. And it's customary that I introduce a speaker once he comes onto the stage. But I can do that for probably an hour. But there's one very good idea that I have in my mind, and that is that you already know him. He's extremely popular. The winner of all hearts already, I believe. And right now he is here to deliver his eulogy on his grandfather. May I now request the technical team to get with the job. So it's time for the first stages. One eloquent speaker, one speaker. May I now enlist for you all what all is he good at? So much. Let's just cut down on that and bring out Toastmaster Tejas for his project. Toastmaster Tejas, everything goes away. Everything goes away.
Begin to comprehend what a more important date for me is. 5th of December 1999, when my grandfather touched my forehead and blessed me for the very first time. Or the 5th of January 2017, when I bowed down in front of him, seeking his blessings for the very last time. The earliest and the first memory that I have of myself is that of a small child. I was around 2 years old. I was drinking milk from a sipper and I was thinking. I was so lazy that I had peed in my pants and I didn't drink it. I was asleep, my eyes were closed. Suddenly, I heard footsteps up. I looked around. And as a cute little baby, I opened my eyes and looked and saw a tall, lanky man standing. If it was me that day, in that moment, I would have given him the warmest of smiles because I could understand the affection that he had showed in me in that one blush of his smile, in his smile. He came to me, lifted me up in his arms, and moved me to another side of the bed. Cleaned the bed, changed my pants, put me back into that place and lulled me to sleep with nothing but love in his eyes and warmth in his arms. This was where I was told. Good evening, one and all present. Then I was around 7 or 8 years old. I was in my 3rd standard. Dada had come to Ahmedabad to pay us a visit. I was one of those kids who loved going to school. I never ever missed a day in school. But it was that one Friday. That one Friday when I couldn't muster the courage to go to school. I faked a stomach ache, still back. I simply didn't want to go back to school because Dada was there for the time. At noon, Dada called me, "Tejas, come for lunch." I am not at all ashamed. I am extremely proud to say that whenever I was with Dada, at any point of time, till I was 17, Dada used to feed me with his very own hands every single time. And even in that day, on that day, he had crushed some roti, added lots of vegetables, put some curd. And even right now, my mouth is watering thinking about that greenish yellow concoction that which he had made up. He fed it to me with his very good hands. That was just the thing that I needed in that hot summer of Ahmedabad. That cool concoction of his. some years past, I grew up in the 50s. It was the time for my 12th years. Tata was in the vein of his years. His health had begun to deteriorate for the past years. My mother and my grandma would constantly bicker me, study, study, study. And you all know what we are, you don't want to study. Dada understood. Dada would simply ask me in the new evenings to come with him to the physical center with him. On the way to the physical center, he would tell me stories about how he developed his hobby of writing poems, about how what type of words will make an impression on teachers, about what, how to write in a beautiful handwriting so that the board teachers give marks. I never even understood that he was teaching me Hindi even after taking me out of it. For me, it was a fun, joy walk with the teachers. In those nights after dinner, I would simply sit next to Dada and write, practice writing Hindi. As I would write and write, Dada would be sitting next to me wearing his thick glasses and looking at the newspaper, cutting out beautiful pictures and small factoids, sticking them in scrapbook and giving it to me for a fun day. As soon as an hour or so passed, he would always have some trophies, I don't know from where, he would always have some fun trophies as rewards that yes, they just studied Christmas today, he should be rewarded. In all of that, the one thing that strikes me the most is that I was never there for him. Till that point of time, I never thought that this person always thinks about me. But did I ever think about him? Then, as everybody knows, I joined ISL. It was the 26th of November 2016. My father called me up and said, Dada is at there. Reach for that. My hands were shaking, my legs were trembling. I was completely nervous. But there was this one thing which was even more nervous than I was. That was my father's eyes. I couldn't wait. I simply packed my bag and went for it. As fast as the 11:40 shift which would take me, I reached for another 1:40. We stayed in the hospital for around 15 minutes. Day and night were one. We didn't know anything but we simply served them. It was now the 5th of January. Dada had been in the hospital for almost 2 days. It was 2 in the night. Dada had become so weak that he couldn't even speak. I was sitting by his bedside at home. He gestured to me. Because he couldn't speak, the words weren't forming in his mouth. He couldn't speak, he gestured to me that he was good. And in that moment, I clearly remember, I could find simply a bowl, some warm milk, which I simply poured, some pieces of wood, which I crushed, and some sugar, which I had to add because. And this concoction, this porridge of mine, I fed it to him with my very own hands at 2 in the night. And I was good. And I was good. At around 3, my uncle Kaka woke up and told me that we should exchange shifts now because I had been away for the past 4 hours. So we exchanged shifts. At 8:30 in the morning, Dadi had just come in.
It's like a bad eye.
Kaka was standing next to Dada's bed. As soon as my eyes opened, I sprang up. I think I saw a glimmer of a tear in my uncle's eyes, but I was not sure. All of a sudden, the phone rang. I picked it up. It was Papa. Papa just landed from America. Listening to my phone's ringtone, understanding that Papa had come back from Ahmedabad, my uncle touched Dada's forehead and he moved his hand up to his nostrils.
Daddy suddenly started saying prayers. I told Papa to hurry up. I cut the phone. Dada was gone. And everything was worse. But was it? Was it really worse? Because everybody in my family was distraught that their own Bhatka Bhaiji, Dilip Bagrecha, had passed away. But it wasn't so bad. Why? Because it had culminated in the most spectacular fashion. Even in his going stage, he had successfully imbibed in me the very strong virtues of hard work, of perseverance, and the vices of loving and caring for everyone unconditionally. Even in that last moment with him, he had given me that opportunity to show my efforts, my sweetness, and my warmth to him, both literally and metaphorically. In all of these feelings, there was only one quote which struck in my mind, which kept me going through these past 2 years. Love everyone, care for everyone unconditionally, because in the end, everything and everyone goes away, but nothing is ever worse.